Howdy, my name's Chris Stoner. I'm the State Conservation Engineer for the Natural Resources Conservation Service for Oklahoma. I'm here today at the ARS Hydraulic Engineering Research Unit in Stillwater to demonstrate pipe flow through structures. I'm going to be running these tests in this portable channel, which allows us to do various things that affect pipe flow. We can change the flow rate, we can change the slope, we can add tailwater, a lot of different things, and insert different structures into the model to evaluate various conditions. Today I'm going to focus primarily on pipes. The way the channel works, there's a storage container for water in the bottom and a pump system that recirculates the water up through the model and back out the other side. What this allows us to do is look at what's happening inside pipes under conditions that we wouldn't normally get to see, unless you happen to actually be in the field at a time when those conditions are happening, which would typically mean you're out in the middle of a thunderstorm sometime and not probably a good place to be. So I'm going to start out with a pipe that is just straight across the top. Most pipes are manufactured in this fashion, so this could be a very typical type installation. So we'll put that into the model. I'll turn the pump on, which represents the rainfall that would start flowing. I've inserted a barrier into the model and then sketched out what the back half of the dam or the roadway would look like. So that's the black line. The dashed line is at the same height as the barrier. And that would be like our auxiliary spillway. The pipe is going to be our principal spillway. And if water flows over the top of the barrier, then we've got flow in the auxiliary spillway. If it flows over the sides of the channel, we've got more problems. We've got flow over the top of the dam or over the top of the roadway. So I'll start the pump. Again, this represents the rainfall event that's happening. Starts raining, we start getting runoff. The water flows down, hits the barrier, and starts flowing through the pipe. As more water, more rain keeps happening, the water gets deeper and deeper on the back side of the dam. The pipe, as you can see, is still not flowing full. And the water, there's more water coming in than the pipe is able to discharge. So the water keeps getting deeper and deeper, and at some point, the pipe may ultimately flow full, or it's just too much water coming in and we'll start overtopping our roadway or overtopping the dam. I'm gonna mark on the side here the depth of the water just for a reference for other tests that we're gonna do later. So things have kind of equalized out. We've got about the same amount of water coming in. It's not rising very, very rapidly anymore, but our pipe is still not flowing full. So I'm gonna demonstrate a couple of other different types of pipes. This particular one is sloped on the end. And this could be, you've probably seen that on roadways quite a bit, road culverts. They're primarily looking at safety aspects of a car running into this and not really that concerned about the hydraulics of that pipe. But it is something that you see a lot, so we'll see how it acts in the model as well. So we've changed out our pipes, the pipe size, everything else is the same. All we've done is change the entrance of the water coming into the pipe. So it starts raining again, the runoff starts flowing. And you can see, again, a lot of turbulence at the entrance of the pipe, and our pipe is still not flowing anywhere close to being full, and we're getting water building up on the back side of the dam. quite a bit of turbulence, you can even see a vortex developing, that little tornado whirlpool effect that happens, but lots of turbulence inside the pipe, which can actually damage the pipe even to the point of failure. So this pipe is flowing at about the same amount of water that the other was. We're nearing the same elevation of the water, maybe even a little bit less. And finally we get up to that level, and now you can see that the pipe is flowing full. But we would really like to try to minimize the depth of water that it takes to fill the pipe, because the deeper the water gets, the higher the dam we have to build, which costs more money in the long run. Or if we don't build it to that way, it's going to go over the top of the dam, or it's going to flood out your roadway. So now we're going to look at just simply taking that same style of inlet and turning it over 180 degrees. So now, instead of it being sloped like a road culvert would be, it's going to be sloped at the opposite angle. Again, the pipe size is the same amount of water is coming in. The only thing we've done is changing the entrance conditions on the water and how the water gets into the pipe. We've already primed the pipe fully. The pipe is flowing full. And just as a reference now, that difference between those two red lines is the difference in the height of the dam that we would have to build, or the height of the roadway that we would have to build. So saving tremendous amount of money in just dealing with the entrance conditions on the pipe. One thing you may notice is I mentioned the whirlpools earlier, and those turbulence that can affect. Here we've got one forming. So we're getting the pipe full, we're getting more water in it, but we still have to deal with those vortices. And through research, there's a couple of different devices that come up with that are basically called anti-vortex devices. One is a vertical anti-vortex plate, the other one is horizontal. And if we stick those into the model, they can significantly reduce the amount of vortices that you see. Anytime you're getting those vortices, one, you're not as efficient with the water flowing through the pipe, but primarily it's the damage that those vortices can be causing. So that's the horizontal. I'll put in the vertical. That's the vertical, I'll put in the horizontal. And these worked really well, except they're a little bit difficult to construct, and they're also difficult to maintain. They get bent as you get debris flowing into your pond or trying to get out your pipe. So we're still looking for some other kind of alternatives that would be an easier solution to that vortice problem. So most of what we installed today is called a canopy inlet, and this has a steel plate, and the size of that plate is a design function of the pipe, and it replaces that anti-vortex big wings that you have sticking out on the pipes, but does the same thing. It keeps the pipe keeps the vortices from developing, and provides a nice clean entrance of water into the pipe. And if you pay attention to the flow in the pipe and watch it, how rapidly the pipe does fill compared to the earlier models that we were running. So we're at about the same elevation as we were earlier. It actually primed or started flowing full a little bit quicker than the other other style did, but very clean entrance of water going into the pipe. Very, very little vortices problems with this type of structure. Now, one thing we solve one problem in engineering, sometimes you can create others. And as we started getting bigger and bigger canopy inlet type structures being built, we actually had some failures of the pipes, and this sliced portion of the pipe would just collapse in upon itself. And so I talked to the guys out here at the ARS lab and said, you know, could y'all come up with something that we could test that, we could model that. And just by simply taking a piece of transparency film and fabricating it to scale to the dimensions of the canopy, we were able to test this, and we can test it to the exact same kind of failure conditions that we would see, or that we were seeing out in the landscape. Since that time, we've done some other studies trying to figure out. We know now it does happen. We're trying to figure out why it happens and what we can do to prevent that. At what conditions do we need to be worried about that happening? And there's a lot of complex hydraulics that's going on inside that pipe right there. There's a lot of negative pressures being developed and forces going on. And so we've yet to really come up with any firm solutions. It's just more research that's needed. We have, however, on certain size pipes, or especially our larger pipes, and under the right flow conditions, reinforced one side or both sides of that pipe to keep that collapse problem from happening. And so far that's worked, but that's not really the best engineering. We'd really want to try to get to a solution that we know is going to work every time. So as the water continues to rise, we can see the little transparency film in there start to flutter, and eventually it will just completely pull in on itself, closing up a big portion of the pipe, which now the pipe's not flowing near as much water as it was. The water gets deeper in behind the dam, goes out the spillway, washes out the dam. A lot of bad things can happen in that condition. I'm gonna put the heavier duty canopy back in and change gears a little bit and talk about aging infrastructure. We've got lots of dams, lots of farm ponds, lots of county road culverts that have been installed for many, many years. And a lot of those have metal pipes. Some of them have corrugated or have concrete pipes. Both of those have a lifespan, and they can deteriorate over time, corrode and create holes in the pipe. Concrete pipe can get damaged by an earthquake like we seem to be having a lot of here in Oklahoma lately, or be damaged, you know, from some other source. But want to demonstrate what a hole inside a pipe can cause. So we're going to get the pipe flowing full again. Mentioned earlier, there's lots of negative pressures that develop inside the pipes as they're flowing full. It makes it very hydraulically efficient because you can get a lot more water flowing through there than you might otherwise. But so we've got our pipe flowing full, and we're going to simulate a metal pipe that's got a hole in it from corrosion. And by doing so, those negative pressures start sucking in air. In this case, air. If you look within our cross section of our dam here, if that hole was actually inside the dam, it's not gonna be sucking air, it's gonna be sucking soil. And if the more soil that we lose, the more potential we have for that dam to fail. So really important that we stay on top of our operation and maintenance programs and do what's necessary to take care of that aging infrastructure that's out there that's providing, you know, all kinds of benefits to the counties, to the people that live below these dams and those kind of things, and can continue to do so just as long as we can keep them maintained. This is just one of the number of demonstration and research tools that are available here at the Hydraulic Engineering Research Lab in Stillwater. The work that they do has been used by NRCS engineers and others and saved millions of dollars and probably countless lives by allowing engineers to design safe and efficient structures. Thanks for watching.